The room is terribly cold. Winter has arrived. The girl, now a woman, stands in the middle of the room. A blanket of snow now covers the dead leaves. Frosted windows let through only a milky haze of diffused light of the two moons. Day and night flow in opposite directions, ending up in a standstill. The sound of a clock ticking echoes in the empty palace, creating a rhythmic gallop, a polyrhythmic cascade into pure noise. She tries to scream, but the air is so cold that she can't properly inhale. From the opposite side of the room, footsteps start to appear in the snow, with heavy steps, felt and seen but not heard. Whatever is coming gets closer and closer. She closes her mind, her eyelids ram closed like blast doors in a nuclear bunker. This is not real. This is only a dream, she declares, grasping for dreamer's control. A thundering blast, a standing wave of immense pressure makes her clothes fill on their own. The feeling of the unheard sound is so immense that it pulses, disrupts the dreamer's heart. There it all ends, in the beginning. Judy is awakened by gravity. The drop from the hotel bed to the carpet lasts less time than her confusion. The impact sends a series of soft cracks down her spine, and she gets the wind knocked out of her. There on the floor, with the faint smell of sand from the carpet, she gasps for air and grasps for reality. Now the pain registers. She bit the inside of her cheek when she fell, and the taste of blood now fills her mouth. On all fours, she crawls to the bathroom door and up to the toilet, spitting a nasty mouthful of crimson blood to the bowl. Hotel mornings on work trips are a special kind of hell on earth for Richard. You wake alone and disoriented in an unfamiliar place. Before you open your eyes, you may think you are in your own bed, but the illusion breaks with existential whiplash when you are yanked to the reality of single-serving soap and disposable razors. This morning, Richard would happily take that single instant of illusion, as he has been laying in his bed, mostly awake since 3 a.m. The sudden crash to dreams last night had not provided rest for the whole night. As he woke up sweating profusely, his heart pounding, he rushed out of bed like the nightmares would be coming up behind him, and there he stood in the middle of the night, still wearing the dress shirt from yesterday, now drenched in sweat. His mind was screaming, "What? What happened?" But his memory was stonewalling him, not letting him remember the horrors that had gotten him so distraught. He took off the shirt and noticed that in his violent thrashing about, a couple of buttons had come loose, now hiding between the sheets. He had not lost a button on his shirt since that one winter when Christopher got really into sourdough baking, and they both had put on some 10 pounds. After finding the buttons intact under the covers, luckily the thread gave away before the plastic of the buttons did. He turned on the lights in the bathroom, wet a towel with water as hot as the faucet would give, and wiped his face, shoulders and armpits with it. Feeling somewhat refreshed, he had tried to stare down his own reflection in the bathroom mirror. "What?" he asked the old man in the mirror. "What got you so worked up?" Richard in the mirror volunteered nothing, so the man in this sack of old skin and tired flesh reached for the light switch and stumbled back to bed. "I must be truly wicked," he grunts to himself, 4 hours later, pushing out of the bed, having just stared at the ceiling. Whatever he had seen in his nightmares had him running so amped that nothing has been able to calm him down. For a fleeting moment, Rich regrets that he did not take the meditation course at the community center together with Christopher, but somehow he knows that no matter how many guided and overtly spiritualized breathing exercises he would have taken, it would not have helped him shake this fear. Just as Richard exits the room to wander down the carpeted hallways in search of the hotel breakfast, he finds a thin piece of linen cloth, purest of white, but almost see-through thin, laid to rest on the back of the chair. Did the cleaning crew leave this here yesterday? And as I arrived late, I just didn't notice. He folds the cloth twice and sets it on the corner of the table. They'll take it with them when they come to clean later today. At the hotel breakfast table, two ghosts meet after a short phone call to agree on the time. Judy winches, as uttering even the grunt of a greeting hurts her cheek. "You do, huh?" Richard says to his coffee cup, taking a sip of the elixir of life, surrounded by people who are heading somewhere. some in anticipation of something new, others going home. There is a kind of pulsing benign anxiety in the air. The hotel is only a mid-sized one, in a mid-sized or even a small city, but there are still 20-something people here, all with their separate stories. For the two journalists on the hunt for human interest stories, the atmosphere here seems strangely invigorating. After the second cup of coffee and surprisingly good toasted bagel, eaten with only the left side of her mouth, Judy feels about ready to face the world. Richard is feeling the restless night much more. Due to his age, but the years also bring a kind of relentless drive, so they both agreed to meet in the car in 15 minutes. John is waiting in front of the county library, parked in his big red Ford truck. When the journalist pull up next to him, he smiles and gets out. Inside the library, they head to the back, to the newspaper archive, after a quick conversation with the librarian at the front desk. John seems a bit distracted, wandering off after a couple of minutes. Judy feels like she's pulled into the county politics, not in my backyard intrigue, as the general dissatisfaction jumps out of the papers. It's like being blasted to the face with an air horn of negativity. Apparently that is not quite as modern an invention as Twitter and Facebook would lead one to believe. In the course of the next hour, the journalists find the articles about the police harassment case. But the alleged murder seems completely evasive. They decide to break off just before noon and head to a roadside diner a bit outside town, a place where John says they at least wash the plates. It seems John is having a bad day overall, as they find a 60s-style diner full of satisfied customers and soon count themselves among those happy few. During the meal, John gets a phone call on his cell phone and his mood seems to improve, as he tells that he has located the potential lead, the young man who told him about the murder in the first place. They'll head to meet him as soon as the meal is over. The man they are going to meet is Jack Goodman, the younger of two brothers John says he often employs to work on his property. There is a kind of an affection in his voice when he talks about the two brothers. His southern bar lands, slowly changing into something resembling mid-Atlantic accent. The reporters silently exchange a pair of looks, as if to shout, "What the f*** is this all about?" John leads them back to the town proper, down a street crossing what would be considered the main street. There they find, just around the corner from a hardware store next to an old apothecary, where vintage signs advertising a new soda fountain hang in the windows, possibly there since the late 50s. A nondescript storefront with tinted windows and a sticker of a black sheep in the middle of some kind of a maze. This, according to John, is the Black Sheep Inc., an apparent refuge for self-proclaimed misfits. They knock on the door, and when a shop clerk in a sleeveless shirt with his arms full of tattoos opens the door, John explains that these two strangers are there to meet Jack. The clerk nods and lets the two of them in. John heads back to his truck. In a sudden panic, Judy asks if John is not coming in. The red beard explains that he's going to pick up some concrete and head back to the house. As the door closes, they are left in this small storefront, where everything is painted black, and behind that door we will leave them today, at least for a while. World Machine is a work of fiction. Names, characters, places and incidents either are the products of the author's imagination, or are used fictitiously. Any resemblance to actual events or locales or persons living or dead is entirely coincidental. If you like this research, be sure to like and subscribe so we could together make more people block out their nightmares.